Eva, dirt cheap, heavens to mercy, faithful, sayana, adios, muchachos, dame, who I'm bucking my food, they shoot, Mr. Chippoos, I'm about to wreck shop with a judo chop, a judo chop, a judo chop.
Still up with the Indugu Business and Leadership Academy, and I'm sitting here with the legendary Chip Fu, Jungle Rock Jr.
That's people.
All right, from the Fu-Schnickens crew. How you doing, sir?
I'm pretty good, man. Pretty good.
All right.
It's here working. It's here working.
All right, that's what's up, man. We out here in Brooklyn in the studio. He's working on some stuff he got coming out. So we definitely want to, kind of pick his brain a little bit.
Okay.
All right. So now I know, we're going to talk about the music and stuff a little bit later.
Mm-hmm.
But I know right now you're working on, you have a program in the school system.
Yes.
Called MAATH. All right. Okay. Tell us about that, how that came about.
MAATH, which is an acronym for Music Appreciation, Art, Time, and Healing. It came about by accident, actually. I did a record called MAATH, Music Appreciation, Art, Time, and Healing. And I never put the record out. And it was getting to a point in my life where I was getting tired of just doing music. And I think that when you give people music, you got to give more than just music, man, especially yourself. Because when you listen to a record, you tend to get an idea what the person may be like, right? But in my mind, I was figuring, instead of just giving music, man, we got to give something more, and I wanted to give back. And, you know, more so now in my life, it's about being more purposeful. So I figured start up this initiative called MAATH, Music Appreciation, Art, Time, and Healing, throughout the schools in Brooklyn. And I'm in 9 different schools in Brooklyn, 1 in Queens, and we're we are stretching out to Canada along with LA.
Uh-huh.
It's a mentoring workshop, but the beauty of it is I built an entire curriculum from start to finish, and I think the Department of Education was more so shocked that I was able to come in and build a curriculum that could work within the DOE standards, within the school systems from September to December, and then from December to June, you know what I mean? And more so they figure that an MC doesn't have that sort of, you know, mental capacity in order to build initiatives like that or to build curriculums on that level to basically stimulate the minds of the youth of today. But they gave me 45 minutes in an ALC school, an alternative learning center for kids that it's tough for them to learn, and they come from a lot of hardships, backgrounds. I was able to teach the school like it was nothing. So they actually put me in 5 other ALC schools in Brooklyn, and I actually turned it around where when it came to certain subjects, what I did was add music to the subject. So if you needed to learn more about your social studies and there was a certain thing that you needed to learn about, or a certain year or a certain thing that happened in time, we'd actually write a song about it and just record it. So the kids can actually listen to certain records that they hear on radio track-wise, but we actually rewrite the song so it speaks to them when it comes to whether it be science, social studies, or whatever. And what that did was just change the way teachers of today view learning, you know what I mean? So I'm kind of happy with that.
That's cool. I know, can we see like a lot of different artists doing things? I know the Jizza, he's tapping into the STEM mm-hmm. programs, you know, teaching, you know, science, technology, mm-hmm. you know, using hip hop as a vehicle to do so.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I see what you're doing is pretty great.
Appreciate
now,
that.
Now, how do you measure success with your program?
How do I measure success? The dropout rate of when I go to these schools.
Okay.
The majority of the time, since it's an ALC school or a suspension site, I don't want to call it that, these kids don't want to go back to them, don't want to go to the suspension site. And normally they're there for 6 months to a year, depending on what cases that they have. The majority of the time, the kids don't come to the suspension site. They just hang out until they get a letter of recommendation to go back to their day school.
Okay.
So with me, when the kids come to my program, they don't want to go back to their regular schooling.
Wow.
They don't want to go back to their day school because they understand that once they go back to their day school, everything that they learn, they have to just toss it to the side because it's, you know, they'll have to go back to the posturing, and they'd have to go back to the lies, and they'd have to go back to, you know, being something that they aren't, you know what I mean? And okay. It's a beautiful thing to understand that I was able to raise the level of attendance in each school that I'm in.
Wow.
You know, not just with blacks, Hispanics, whites, you know, everything mixed, but and just by using the power of music. I mean, there was one girl, because I've been in the business for 5 years, and every school, every detention site that she was sent to, they were saying that she'll never graduate, right? Every time I went to those schools, I said, you know something, leave her with me. You know, let her take my classes.
Right.
The first thing that we did is I you know, you have to empower a child. I was like, listen, we're going to do this video. We're going to remake Rihanna's work. And what we're going to do is pitch it to the Department of Education, where we're going to rewrite the song and have somebody in a school sing over the song talking about how important it is to do your work in school.
Oh.
We did it. I told her that she is the person that has to write the treatment for the video. She wrote the treatment for the video. Like she took time out, wrote the treatment for the video. I brought in a videographer. They filmed the video, and it changed her life. So this year passed, she graduated. Okay. And the people from the suspension site sent me pictures of her and her cap and gown, and they thought it would never happen. So for me, that's me sitting back saying that an idea that I had sitting down in my house at my table was able to change the life or lives of several other people just by instilling my way of thinking into people, which is, you know, you can't really give up. And, you know, even though you have hardships and pain, you got to get past it. Because before even, you know, taking it on as much as I did, at that point where when I started going into the schools, my mother was diagnosed with stage 4 cancer. So in my mind, I'm like, I'm teaching these kids all of this, and these kids are looking at me. I can't falter at any point.
Right.
So I figured that the same thing I was teaching these kids, I need to apply to my life, and it has also helped me. You know what I'm saying? It was basically like giving back to myself. So to see all these kids graduate and continue to call me and come in and, like, if I did a workshop here, they would come in and teach the kids.
Okay.
And I'd be able to sit down and watch some students that I taught teach these kids.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like today, after this meeting with you, one of my students invited me to dinner because he has this business thing that he's about to do, and he just wanted my take on it.
Okay.
And I think that it's a beautiful thing for them to get to the point where they're able to say, you know something, I'm gonna call Chip right now and just tell Chip, you know, what we're doing. They have their own independent record company right now.
Oh, wow.
Have their own studio, right? And this all started in housing.
Hmm.
We went in, did the program. They know how to make music to the point where people are listening to them. They're performing all over the place. And now they're just like, yo, we want to talk to you about, you know, other things. So I think that that's what motivates me more when, you know, I get hit up in, you know, on my phone and they're talking about, yo, you know, when are you going to have more classes? I'd like to come back and teach, because whatever it is that I gave them, it did wonders for their life. You know what I mean? So,
So I guess, you know, with so much talk about what's going on in the school system, and as you said, a lot of the administration was saying that they weren't able to reach these kids.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what, I guess, is your secret sauce, or what, you know, what about, what do you provide that these, well, what do you do that these school systems aren't doing to help reach these kids?
Listen, I think the biggest problem is teachers don't listen.
Okay.
I think when teachers come in to teach, they think that their job is only to teach and not to listen. Now, the thing about it with certain kids is if you walk into a school and you say, I have a book and I'm going to give you this book, and the book is See Spot Run, right?
Right.
Some kids can't learn by reading See Spot Run. They have to actually see Spot Run.
Right.
Right? And then they'll get it. Some people is visual, some people is, you got to really show them so they could really see it. If they read it, they might be like, yo, I still don't get this. So the difference with me is I'll sit and listen and say, well, you know, what's the problem, and approach them more like a mentor than a teacher. There's a difference. Teachers teach because they come in with their curriculums and they sit down and they say to themselves, well, I'm going to teach from A to Z, here's my aim, I have 45 minutes. If you don't get it, then you just go home and do your homework, and when you come back, that's what it is. You get me?
Right.
So at the end of the day,